So our anesthetic aims are to optimize the patient for the functional status of thyroid and associated comorbidities, continuation of the thyroid medications. Airway management plan should be done in the preoperative itself. Whenever we have a small swelling with no evidence of compressive symptoms, one can go for conventional video laryngoscopy or with endotracheal intubation. But in a case with large swelling and evidence of compression and deviation, like in our case, awake fiber optic intubation is the preferred choice of airway management. One should always anticipate tracheal collapse by a huge swelling or loss of the muscle tone and should avoid giving muscle relaxants and inhalation agents at the time of induction. Sometimes even lifting of the swelling is required for the ease of intubation. Swellings with retrosternal extension may require sternotomy.
स्लाइड शो शुरू कर दीजिए. हम स्लाइड शो बाकी दिख तो रही है हमको. स्लाइड फुल स्लाइड शो पे आ जाइए. ठीक है गुड. आपको अपनी वॉइस बोलनी पड़ेगी. मैडम आपकी वॉइस नहीं आ रही है. आप
वॉइस नहीं आ रही
है. आप जब बोल रही थी वो बोली. आप बोल नहीं रही ना. आप स्लाइड को मत चलाइए. आप खुद बोल रही थी वही करिए. ठीक है स्लाइड सेवन.
Okay. So plan in a patient which has to undergo total thyroidectomy is general anesthesia with endotracheal intubation and controlled ventilation. In a case with hyperthyroidism, thiapentone is the preferred agent of choice because it prevents peripheral conversion of T4 to T3. Although propofol can also be used because of the faster onset of action and recovery, and it also prevents post-op nausea and vomiting. It is better to avoid ketamine and vagolytic agents because of the sympathetic stimulation. Hyperdynamic circulation is present in these patients, so induction should be done slowly. So what is the preferred endotracheal tube in patients who are undergoing huge thyroid swelling? The preferred tubes are definitely flexometallic endotracheal tube because they do not kink and they do not get compressed. They should be fixed beyond the compression or swelling to prevent any difficulty in ventilation in the intraoperative period. Tube should be fixed properly to prevent any accidental extubation or pull out during the surgical manipulation. Other special tubes which are known as NIM EMG tubes or neural integrity monitoring electromyogram tubes, they are used to assess the integrity of the recurrent laryngeal nerve or supralaryngeal nerve intraoperatively, as they measure the evoked potentials from the vocalis muscle. Conventional thyroidectomy requires head and up and neck extended position, which is known as Rose position. The advantage of this position is that it makes thyroid prominent and decreases the venous congestion, but it has some disadvantages, which are there are more chances of tube dislodgement, increased risk of air embolism because of the negative pressure which is created in the neck veins. Arms are usually adducted, so one should ensure extension tubing with IV lines. Eyes should be protected, especially in patients who have exophthalmos. All the pressure points should be padded to prevent the nerve injury. Adequate depth of anesthesia is to be maintained using supplemental narcotics like fentanyl, inhalational agents, sevoflurane, isoflurane. Muscle relaxants, etracurium, bicuronium, rocurinium can be used, but if there is possibility of myopathy with these patients, then it will prolong the neuromuscular blockade effect, and one should keep this in mind. Pancuronium is avoided as it increases the sympathetic activity. There should be meticulous fluid replacement along with the blood loss. Normothermia, normoxia, normocarbia should be maintained. Reversal is usually done with a glycopyrrolate and nystagmin in the usual doses. Intraoperative monitoring is as per the standard ASA monitoring, ECG for heart rate and arrhythmias, non-invasive blood pressure monitoring, temperature monitoring, which is of utmost importance in these patients, SpO2 monitoring and tidal carbon dioxide monitoring, respiratory gas monitoring, and neuromuscular monitoring is although optional, but intraoperative neuromonitoring can be done either by the direct visualization of the vocal cord function, which is difficult, and it can also be done by the NIM tubes, which have the embedded several electrodes above the cuff. And one should be very particular in positioning of these tubes, because these tubes should directly lie on the vocal cords to track the EMG activity of the laryngeal muscles. And these laryngeal muscles activity is transmitted to the motor, this monitor, which can provide signals either in the audible form or in the visual form to the surgeons for the superior laryngeal nerve and recurrent laryngeal nerve injury. There should not be any axial rotation or lateral displacement of endotracheal tubes, because it may affect the signal quality. There is controversy regarding the use of inhalational agents, that halogenated agents and nitrous oxide, they depress the IONM signals. TY is usually preferred as it increases the better interoperative signals due to the muscle relaxation. Intraoperative complications in patients who are undergoing thyroidectomy are very challenging. Bradyarrhythmias because of the carotid body stimulation can be there, and the management includes stopping of the surgery, lignocaine infiltration around the carotid body, and avoidance of atropine. Excessive bleeding, because thyroid itself is a vascularized gland and it lies in the vicinity of the major vessels, is a problem, and one should always arrange blood in these patients. The bleeding can also lead to acute hypotension, which may require direct sympathomimetics like phenylephrine in hyperthyroid patients, and one can require indirect sympathomimetics like ephedrine, dopamine, or epinephrine in hypothyroid patients. There is always risk of damaging recurrent laryngeal nerve or superior laryngeal nerve along with the surrounding structures. Ear embolism is also one of the known complications in the patients, because the surgery is usually done above the level of the heart. There can be accidental extubation, disconnections, or kinking. There are more chances of thyroid storm in patients who are not prepared properly in the preoperative phase, and there can be difficult ventilation intraoperatively due to the surgical manipulation in huge thyroid especially. Pain management is usually done in these patients using a multimodal approach with the use of shorter acting opioids, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, paracetamol. One can go for infiltration of the operative site with local anesthetics, or one can also use ultrasound-guided superficial cervical plexus block. Post-op nausea vomiting using traditional anti-emetics and dexamethasone is used, and it should always be done, because whenever there is a retching and vomiting, it can lead to hematoma post-operatively. There are extubation concerns in this patient with a huge thyroid swelling, and they are tracheomalacia, vocal cord palsy, hemodynamic instability, concerns of prolonged muscle paralysis, and laryngeal edema. Tracheomalacia leads to post-extubation stridor and respiratory distress due to the airway collapsibility post-operatively. Sir has already talked about tracheomalacia in detail, and it usually occurs in long-standing goiter with tracheal narrowing. The diagnosis is usually made by the surgeons intraoperatively, and they can feel for the soft and floppy trachea. There are other two tests. One is cuff leak test and another is pull-out test to diagnose tracheomalacia. Cuff leak test measures an auscultate cuff leak after deflating cuff when tube is within situ, and the cutoff values for cuff leak volume is less than 110 ml or less than 10 to 15% of the delivered tidal volume. It is important to remember that lesser the leak volume, higher are the chances of the post-extubation stridor. Pull-out test is done when one is trying to extubate the patient on the fiber optic bronchoscope, and the patient may lose the spontaneous respiration during the gradual withdrawal of the endotracheal tube. And this also predicts the tracheomalacia. With the availability of ultrasound in the operation theater these days, laryngeal ultrasound can be done to predict the post-extubation stridor. One can go for laryngeal air column width, measure it before and after the endotracheal cuff deflation, and can measure the air column width difference at the vocal cord. Management of tracheomalacia includes intraoperatively artificial tracheal support, and post-operative, one should plan for elective ventilation. Now, coming to the steps of extubation, before extubating, ensure complete reversal of the neuromuscular blockade followed by the assessment of the vocal cord using direct laryngoscopy or video laryngoscope. One can also go for fiber optic visualization of the vocal cord through LMA. There are many methods to assess vocal cord movement by the ultrasound guided assessment of the vocal cord movement. Before extubation, the key question to be answered is it safe to remove the endotracheal tube? If the answer is yes, then awake extubation should be planned in a huge thyroid swelling. And our aim is always to extubate smoothly without bucking and cuffing. Extubation strategies using advanced techniques are there. One is Bellé maneuver, another is extubation over fiber optic bronchoscope, and the third is extubation over the airway exchange catheters. Bellé maneuver is substituting a LMA for the endotracheal tube while patient is still paralyzed, which is followed by the endotracheal tube cuff deflation and tube removal. When spontaneous breathing is resumed, LMA is removed. Thus, it leads to very smooth extubation. Flexible bronchoscope is advanced to the LMA to visualize the anatomy and of the vocal cord movements. And it has the advantage that whenever we require re-intubation, it can be facilitated through the flexible bronchoscope. Extubation over the airway exchange catheters is preferred usually in huge thyroid swelling with difficult intubations. It is introduced through the tracheal tube. It can lead to spontaneous breathing through it, and oxygenation and respiratory monitoring can be done with the airway exchange catheters in situ. It also serves as a conduit for reintubation. Coming to extubation in ICU, is always planned when one is not sure of the immediate airway patency after extubation. Regional anesthesia for thyroidectomy is usually not practiced routinely because it requires cooperative patients and expertise. It is indicated in patients with severe cardiac and respiratory compromise. The techniques include cervical epidural, bilateral superficial and deep cervical plexus block, which can be performed under monitoring. One should know about the complications of regional anesthesia. In thyroidectomy, they are risk for spinal and epidural injections, vertebral artery puncture, and bilateral phrenic nerve block. Emergency surgery in hyperthyroidism is usually done when we have a life-saving, limb-saving, or organ-saving procedure. The management includes intravenous dexamethasone 2 mg 6 hourly, which reduces the hormone release and peripheral conversion of T4 to T3. Beta blockers like propranolol, esmolol is used to titrate the heart rate, and which can also go with antithyroid drugs via the NG tube. Removal of the thyrotoxic gland does not mean immediate resolution of the thyrotoxicosis. One should always use beta blocker therapy in the post-operative period. Antithyroid drugs can be discontinued after the endocrinologist's advice. Now, coming to the anesthetic concerns in hypothyroidism, these patients, they have increased sensitivity to neuromuscular blocking agents. They are sensitive to the depressant effects of the inhalation agents and opioids. they have a slow metabolism and excretion of drug. They are in the state of hypometabolic state. So always we should go for slow IV induction. Hypodynamic circulation is there. So chances of hypotension are there in these patients while induction. There is always pre-existing myocardial depression depending upon the severity of the hypothyroidism. They are more prone to go in hypothermia and GI hypermotility. They sometimes have a prolonged anesthesia recovery, again depending upon the severity of the hypothyroidism. Coming to myxoedema coma, it's a rare life-threatening complication of long-standing neglected hypothyroidism. It includes triad of altered mental status, which is abrupt in onsets. There's a risk of hypothermia, hypothyroidism, and other abnormalities like hyperventilation, hypoglycemia, hypertension, hyponatremia, and hypomotility of the gut. These patients should always be considered high risk and they should be stabilized before taking further surgery, especially for this emergency surgery. Elective surgery is not indicated in these patients till they are stabilized. Supportive measures and treating the precipitating cause is of utmost importance. Airway protection and ventilation, treatment of hypotension, hypoglycemia, and hypothermia is must. Thyroxine administration, oral or IV in the dose of 300 to 500 micrograms per day should be started in the preoperative period, which is followed by the maintenance dose of 50 to 200 micrograms per day along with the steroids. Endoscopic thyroidectomy is performed in few centers in India. It can be done either by the cervical approach or by the extracervical approach. Cervical approach is usually preferred via videoscopic assisted thyroidectomy in the case of smaller thyroid swellings. Extracervical approaches can be by your axillary route, oral vestibular approach, or by the natural orifice transluminal endoscopic surgery. These are the two pictures of extracervical approach. One is ipsilateral breast axillary approach on the left side, and one is axilla bilateral breast approach on the right side. On the left side, we have a transoral approach picture, and on the right side, we have a post-auricular approach picture. So coming to the post-operative complications, thyroid surgery is not without complications, and usually the complications which occur, they usually occur in the post-operative period. So there should be intense monitoring in this phase. The complications can be early complications like neck hematoma, laryngeal edema, recurrent laryngeal nerve injury, superior laryngeal nerve injury, tracheomalacia, pneumothorax, especially in case of a large thyroid where we also go for radical neck dissection, thyroid storm. Late complications include hypoparathyroidism, hypocalcemia, and hypothyroidism. Thyroid storm is a life-threatening complication and has a high mortality of 20%. Although it is rare due to the widespread use of antithyroid drugs and beta blockers, it may occur intraoperatively or postoperatively 6 to 48 hours later. It is usually precipitated by the inadequate preoperative treatment, sudden release of the T4 or T3 into the circulation. And the causes under anesthesia are inadequate depth of anesthesia, hypoxia, hypovolemia, or surgical manipulation. The clinical presentation under anesthesia includes increased bleeding, increased end-tidal carbon dioxide, early exhaustion of the soda lime, increased temperature, tachycardia, hypertension, or tachyarrhythmias or bradyarrhythmias, CHF, or shock. But when the patient is awake, the patient may present with restlessness, extreme irritability, delirium, seizure, coma, tachypnea, vomiting, abdominal colic, or increased sweating and dehydration. Management of thyroid storm is supportive as well as definitive. Supportive treatment is done by increasing the depth of anesthesia, increasing the oxygen delivery, treating the pyrexia using cold IV fluids and using the cooling mattresses, ice packs, correction of the fluid and electrolytes, and acid-base imbalance. It's a state of a circulatory shock. So IV administration of the direct vasopressors like phenylephrine is needed. Atrial fibrillation using beta-adrenergic blockers and digitalis is done. Dexamethasone in the dose of 2 milligram, 6 hourly, or cortisol 100 to 200 milligram, 8 hourly is given. Antithyroid drugs is a definitive treatment, which includes propylthiouracil in the dose of 200 to 400 milligram, 8 hourly. Tachycardia is treated by the beta blockers, esmolol infusion, 100 to 300 milligram, microgram per kg per minute, or propranolol 0.5 to 1 milligram IV every 1 to 5 minutes. Neck hematoma is another complication which occurs usually after six hours post-operatively. The symptoms are neck swelling, dyspnea, stridor, leading to acute airway obstruction, and the management includes removal of the sutures immediately. So there should always be a suture tray besides the patient's bed. It may require securing airway, or patient may be taken to OT for the evacuation and a hemostasis. Difficult airway cards should always be available in the post-operative area. Laryngeal edema is another complication, and it occurs because of the multiple intubation attempts and because of the traumatic intubation. Large hematoma causing venous obstruction to the laryngeal vessels can lead to stridor or airway obstruction, and the management includes humidified oxygen, steroid, adrenaline nebulization, and it may also require intubation sometimes. Nerve injury like recurrent laryngeal nerve injury or superior nerve injury can be transient or permanent. The incidence is more in large goiters, especially with malignancy or where we have reoperations. The cause is due to traction, transection, entrapment, or nerve injury and ischemia. Bilateral recurrent laryngeal nerve injury, the incidence is 0.4%. And the nerve injury, they follow the Siemens law. That is, in partial injury, abductor fibers are the first to be affected as compared to the adductor fibers. In unilateral incomplete palsy, only abductors are paralyzed as shown in the figure on the left side, and the vocal cord assumes median position, voice is unaffected, and the patient may remain asymptomatic. In the complete palsy, both abductors and adductors are paralyzed, vocal cord assumes paramedium position, and there is hoarseness of voice which is present. In complete palsy, recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy, it could be either partial or complete. In partial injury, both vocal cords assume median or paramedian position with severe inspiratory dyspnea and stridor. And in complete injury, both vocal cords assume cadaveric position, inspiratory stridor, along with a high risk of aspiration. So management includes immediate endotracheal intubation with a smaller tube, followed by the emergent tracheostomy. Superior laryngeal nerve palsy, the incidence is 3.5%. And external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve is the commonest injury, leading to the paralysis of the cricothyroid muscles and resulting voice alteration, which is of significance, especially in the professional singers. Injury to the internal branch of the superior laryngeal nerve results in dysphagia due to the deranged swallowing reflex. Coming to hypocalcemia, the incidence is around 6 to 30%. Signs and symptoms, they usually develop after 24 to 96 hours post-surgery. The cause is because of the vascular spasm to the parathyroid muscle or due to the inadvertent surgical removal of the gland. The presentation of the patient depends upon the severity of hypocalcemia. It could be either laryngeal stridor or in the form of tetany, depending upon the severity. The two signs, Strozier sign and Shevostek signs, can be elicited bedside. Strozier sign includes the carpopedal spasm, which is precipitated by the BP cuff inflation, 20 millimeter HD above the systolic pressure. And Shevostek sign is the is elicited by the facial nerve twitching in response to the tapping over the facial nerve. The management of hypocalcemia depends upon the serum calcium level. If the serum calcium level is more than 2 millimoles per deciliter, we can go for oral calcium and vitamin D supplementation. If the serum calcium is less than 2 millimoles per deciliter, intravenous calcium supplementation can be given along with the serial monitoring of the serum calcium levels. So coming back to my case, my concerns in my case were functional status of the thyroid, intubation concerns, perioperative blood loss, nerve injuries, tracheomalacia, vocal cord palsy, our extubation plan, hypocalcemia, thyroid storm, and hematoma, which I have already covered. Thank you, and best of luck for your exams.